legal and due to city council's order, do we have a roll call, please?
Councilman Anderson.
Here.
Hamilton.
Here.
Mayor Cooley.
Present.
Vice Mayor Hayes.
Present.
Councilman Lee.
Present.
All present.
Could we all rise for a moment of silence, followed by the pledge of allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, do we have any, item one is consider approval of agenda, do we have any additions or corrections?
Okay.
Change, do we have a motion and a second to approve the agenda?
Some move.
Second.
Motion and a second, any discussion? Seeing none, all vote. Okay, item two, tonight we have a presentation of special recognition of the fire department. Chief Kendrick, if you have some awards, like for some.
Yes, sir. Mayor and council, I'm very pleased and honored to award six members of the Cookeville Fire Department with last segment awards. On two separate incidents, we responded to reports of unconscious victims. Once there, our personnel were quickly able to assess and deliver a life-saving shock through the AEDs that we have. Our first call took place on December the 1st of 2006 with Lieutenant Rick O'Hannon, paramedic firefighter Jason Porter, and firefighter Dustin Morgan responding to that call. The second incident took place on January 16th of 2007 with Lieutenant Mark Montgomery, firefighter Jason Stewart, and firefighter Daniel Nord responding to that call. On both calls, there were individuals around these victims that were able to detect the signs of the heart attack, cardiac arrest, and also were able to activate early notification so we could get there in a timely fashion. Both of the calls, being able to have early recognition and early detection, played a major part in surviving from cardiac arrest. We're proud to be a partner with Putnam County EMS in providing training to over 200 locations that have AEDs in the city of Cookeville and Putnam County now to this date. I'd like for those six individuals to step forward and I'll give them these awards. We also have one of the surviving victims with us tonight, Mr. Gary Littrell and his wife. He are also witnesses, and I believe they want to step forward in a few minutes and say something. Have a higher chance of surviving a cardiac arrest if you're in Putnam County than in the nation. Gary or Jennifer, would y'all like to say anything?
Thank y'all for the part that y'all played in the awesome miracle that died before in my life. Quick response, it's a new response. Be awesome for taking care of my black and who is to serve. Just really appreciate all that. Thank you, sir.
brings us to item three in our whole business, which is consider approval of minutes of council meeting held March 15, 2007. We have a motion and a second to approve those. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussions or additions to those minutes? Seeing none? Seeing none, all vote? Okay. Because we had trouble with that, I don't know if the rest of us can vote.
Are we going to do the pressure again?
All those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. That brings us to the new business portion of our meeting tonight. Item four, consider resolution R070405, amending the personnel policies and procedures manual. Sponsor, Jim Burton.
Mayor Council, I will be referring to the memo that you have as part of your agenda package, which has a bit more detail about this. I have the overhead question. Small, if you could read it anyway. The following amendments are proposed to the policies. By the way, this is after a lot of good deliberation by directors. Sometimes I think these are so many, maybe it's better for you several times. The first one is justified section 104, state of Tennessee mandated adoption of code of ethics legislation, which is the ordinance form, is referred to in the new section 104 of chapter 5, which is as follows. Employees are subject to code of ethics as adopted by ordinance 070410. And it is included as appendix to this manual. I understand that this will be presented by the city attorney and the manager myself in the next couple of meetings. The passage, which you may recall, this is prompted by the stuff that happened in Nashville and maybe the Tennessee law issues. It's mandated by state government. We must get an ordinance form to find out who it is part of this meeting. But it will be before you soon. Change number two is chapter 5, section 1205. This section deals with the per diem reimbursement for meals, which currently holds $29 a day. We'd like to change the manual to say that this change will allow for reimbursement in accordance with the Commons of the Continental United States rates for all out of state travel in the state of Tennessee. Rates for level one counties, which are when traveling within the state of Tennessee, which is promulgated by the General Services Administration. $29 a day now is just not adequate for meals. You know, the travel months, it's just not that good. For most non-metropolitan areas in Tennessee, if you look at about $10 total per day, and then the rates for lodging is on the website, General Services website, depending on where you are. If you're in New York, obviously this morning, you may have to pay a national or in a small community like this. We will have those turned out available so all departments will know what those rates are. Check five, section 24, change number three. A new section is added. This is prohibiting the recording of employees. This section states that it shall be a violation of the policy manual for an employee to record another city employee in the workplace without the employee's consent. This includes all audio and video means. This policy does not apply to recordings made at the workplace, specifically authorized by the city manager and approved as to legality by the city attorney. And any recordings made for safety purposes or the recording of broadcast cameras permanently fixed at specific city premises. Nobody likes to be recorded without it being known. You know, in all the workplaces, we sometimes discuss things that are of confidential nature, not meant for public consumption. And that's all this is really about. Change number four is chapter 8, section 205. Regular full-time and part-time employees receive pay for holidays, providing A, they are on the payroll and receiving pay for the scheduled work day preceding and succeeding the holiday, and B, the holiday falls on the regular scheduled work day. An example, an employee who works on Monday through Thursday scheduled will not receive pay for a holiday that falls on Friday. Well, we have not many, but a few employees that work 4 10-hour days. They're finished on Friday. Many of our holidays are observed on Friday. If we follow this language, those people do not get paid for the holiday, but the rest of us do. It doesn't affect me, and we'd like to strike paragraph B, which take that out of the plate. And we're paying them already because we think it's a fair thing to do. We need the language to reflect what we're actually doing, so we'd like to just like to delete paragraph B. Number five, chapter eight, section 30102, this section states that employees of the city may be eligible to continue various benefit coverages, including accident insurance under COVID. This section is amended to delete accident insurance, since accident insurance is not part of COVID. Six, chapter eight, section 6.02. This section deals with the accrual of vacation leave for all regular full-time employees except employees of the fire department. This section is changed to delete any reference to employees hired after June 30th of 2000. We amended the policy manual back in June of 2000, limiting the amount of vacation leave that employees could accumulate to 8 hours per month, regardless of the length of service with the city. This amendment will ensure the graduated rate of accrual depending on length of service that was in place prior to that June 30th amendment. We're going back to where it was before. In retrospect, we realize that's probably going to save. You know, the accumulation benefits is very important to employees. It's a huge incentive to recruitment and to retaining employees. And even when we go back, it's not really excessive. You know, 1 to 9 years is 8 hours a month. You accumulate 8 hours per month. If you work 10 to 19 years, a day and a half, 12 hours per month. And then 20 years plus, 16 hours. Still not excessive, and in retrospect, probably was a mistake to change that so that you can only accumulate that at 8 hours, regardless. So we left the record where it was before. Number seven, chapter eight, section 6.04. This section deals with the accrual of vacation leave for all regular full-time employees. And this is the fire department. It's the very same thing. We're just restoring the same thing to the fire department that had in manual authority, just as we just did on change number six, which was for all non-fire department. Change number eight is chapter eight, section 607. This section requires employees to submit requests for vacation leave at least 5 days prior to retention leave unless an emergency situation occurs. This section is changed to delete the 5 day prior approval requirement. It's not always practical, it's not always possible to do so. Directors would approve the leave anyway as it created a hardship for the department. We would just like to strike the 5 day prior approval requirement. And section 607, part of that same amendment, whereas section, it applies to employees on COVID funding, medical leave, earned vacation leave, as if it were. This section is changed to delete the provision that employees on COVID funding, medical leave, accrued vacation leave, since this is not a requirement of the law. There's a lot of confusion when the law first came out, keeping employees whole and all that. We were pretty sure what all it meant. We realize now we don't have to do. We don't have to do that. Very few employees actually go on FMLA, and we would like to start. And change number nine, chapter eight, section 6.09. This section states that vacation leave shall be used in a minimum of 1 hour increments. This section is changed to read 1 half hour increments. You know, you can pick up a prescription, you can get an allergy shot, you can do a lot of things to be right back at work. And the directors like to change it to a minimum 1 half hour rather than a minimum 1 hour. Change 10, chapter eight, section 16. This section deals with the maximum accrual. Don't get confused with what we talked about. The other is the right accrual. This is about the cap or the maximum leave that we accrued. This section is changed to delete any reference to the maximum accrual limits for employees hired after June 30th of 2000. Note, this change will restore the graduated maximum accrual limits or caps that were in effect prior to June 30th of 2000. 0 to 9 years of employment, 160 hours. 10 to 19 years, 240 hours, 20 plus years, 320 hours. So we're still only talking about 8 weeks for someone who's worked here over 20 years. Right now, 160 hours for non-fire and 240 hours for fire. We'd like to restore the cap that was in place prior to that. And it had been that way for several years before, by the way. Number 11, chapter 8, section 6.2. This is a new section. We're defining something called retirement leave. Retirement leave is defined as leave taken by an employee who is eligible for retirement immediately prior to retirement. Employees will have the option to receive a lump sum payment for accumulated vacation leave, or they may take their accumulated leave and continue to be on the payroll and be paid on a biweekly basis until all vacation leave is used. If the option to receive payment on a biweekly basis is chosen, the employer will cease to accumulate additional sick or vacation leave and will be required to pay health insurance premiums as if retired. Number 12, last one, chapter 8, section 14 on 4. This section states that same thing we did on vacation leave. retaining one half entrance, one half air entrance. I think these are all big changes. I'll be glad to answer your questions. Be ready to approve.
Do we have a motion to go through?
No, President.
Do we have a second? Motion has a second. Any discussion motions?
Number nine, what exactly is the rationale for having, I can't imagine really anything you have to go in 30 minutes.
Number nine?
Number nine, yes. Chapter 8, section 609, changing the vacation from 1 hour to half hour. You can't even get across town in a half hour a lot of times. I can't imagine somebody would need to do that. I can understand sick leave, I mean, because if you get sick at work and you leave, you may be leaving in the middle of the day, or here in the middle of an hour, but the vacation, I really don't understand that.
I'd say if you want for lunch, you want to leave a little bit early, and you only want to leave 30 minutes early, maybe you can charge them 30 minutes early for 4 hours, something like that.
Is that going to create an accounting or a bookkeeping nightmare?
I don't think so.
No.
Actually, I think it's reasonable because that will encourage people, you know, if you have a 30-minute task, why take a full hour? And if you're going to get charged for a full hour, take the full hour. You know, the attitude is, come on back, get back to work, or whatever. So I think it's humane.
Does the increase or the retroactive for the vacation leave, is it going to hurt as far as the number of employees for the fire department? You know, I don't know if everybody could leave at the same time, everybody had, are we concerned at all about that as far as the number of employees?
It's not changing our schedule and all for the part that we'll do.
Okay, I just want to make sure if we had too many people gone, it won't happen.
How do you discuss these changes with the employees? Is it through the directors of the various departments or?
Since there's so many this time, besides the chest up explaining, I intend to meet with the secretaries and have their monthly meeting, talk about all the changes, and probably will take all the changes that actually have to be taken out of the manual as it exists now and sliding all the pages in with instructions. We did that anyway, but since there's so many this time, we'll probably meet with them and have to make sure that everything's up to date. It's real easy to end up the manual that's out of date if you're not careful. We will go to great lengths to make sure that people understand the changes.
Number three, which is the Chapter 5, Section 24, about the reporting of employee. My understanding was in the law that if one party consented to the reporting, that it was legal to do so. Are we going to supersede what that law says by the custodian attorney general at all?
I guess I'll be able to see the attorney that.
The two are not really related. This is a question of the privacy of individual at work not to be recorded. Whether or not it's admissible evidence or not, it has nothing to do with whether or not the city has determined as a matter of policy that one employee should not be taken to court in another. So they're not necessarily connected. It does not interfere. I mean, one employee might report another employee. That might be played in court somewhere, but that the employee that did the recording might be subject to discipline. So they're not necessarily related in that regard.
I suppose, if the person is being harassed on the job and they felt like they should document that in some way, recording it would be one way to document that.
The first thing I would do is follow the policy which says that you're supposed to report the harassment on the job to a supervisor or another person in the chain, and if that person says, well, you know, that's important, let's go to the city manager and bring you up to the reporting place. Yeah. And then that's the city manager can authorize that.
Turns out that nightmare will change.
Looks like you've done quite a bit of work on this. Any further discussion? Any comments from the audience? Very good. All in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign.
Thank
you.
Brings us to item five, consider resolution 070404 expressing intent to reimburse for expenses relative
Mayor and council members, we have a number of projects that are currently being designed, and we're getting ready to kick those projects off. They'll require a bond issue, example is Fairground Lane, possibly extensions, Osgood Park. Those will require a bond issue, it'll be sometime when we get those bonds issued, and we may incur some expenses prior to when that debt is issued, and this resolution will authorize us to reimburse the general fund for any expenses we incur before we get that debt issued. I recommend your approval.
Do we have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion by the council? Any comments from the audience? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign.
Mayor votes motion carries.
Thank you, Ms. Pitts. Item six, consider approval of upgrade of handheld meter reading system, sponsored by Davis.
Mayor and council members, the handheld devices that our meter readers use, they're 15 years old. The company that we work with that supports those is phasing out support of those in November of 07. So we've been looking at the upgrade for those through this company. A purchasing the upgrade, we're basically getting the same system, it's just a Windows-based version instead of like a DOS-based version. It's the biggest key to this is the upgrade will keep the interface between our billing system and the handheld devices. There'll be no program changes we're going to have to make on the backside of the billing system to get this data back and forth between those devices by going with the upgrade. The handhelds themselves, the new handhelds will also support automated meter reading technology, should we move to that in the future also. The total cost of this upgrade is $24,985, and that includes everything we have to have, chargers, the software, everything that will be required for this, and I recommend your approval.
We have a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second. Motion and a second. Any discussion by the council? These, you did say if we did it compared to the wireless, these will...
They have a technology, it's an open architecture where they try to work with those automated meter reading companies out there to use that technology, yes.
And we've got 15 years out of our previous...
15 years out of the other ones. They've held up well. They don't like the rain these days. So that's one issue we have with that system back, because they're not quite as waterproof as they used to be. But the new units certainly will be very vicious in the rain department.
Well, as bad as I hate my meter being red.
Big compatible with the billing system, so that we got no change whatsoever between our billing system and the handheld devices.
But we don't foresee an upgrade in the near future of the billing system.
No, we went through that in 03 and we had no plans. No plans whatsoever.
Any further comments or questions? Any comments from the audience? Yes, sir.
You make sure that if you upgrade to Vista, the Windows Vista, at any point that the software will still be compatible with it?
I don't think we're looking at Vista anytime soon. I may have to defer that to DevLink on their computer area, but I don't think we're looking at Vista anytime in the near future.
Vista being the software or the...
This is the Windows new operating system for Microsoft.
Any further comments? Any questions? Seeing no further comments, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Item 7, consider declaring a surplus property lot number 1 of West Jackson Division Phase 1, sponsored by James Willis.
Thank you, council members. We've received a request for property identified as Parcel 6 on Tax Map 53A Strip F. It's located at the corner of West Jackson Street and Maxwell Street, to be declared a surplus and made available for purchase. The property is further identified as lot number 1 of the West Jackson Street Division Phase 1, and as a remnant of property acquired by the city for the construction of West Jackson Street. Here's an aerial view of the property. According to the recorded plat, The subject property consists of 3/4 acre. It's zoned as CL, local commercial. The recorded plat indicates it's a 20-foot utility easement in width along West Jackson Street. In the review by the applicable departments, the Water Quality Control Department has requested that a utility easement 20 feet in width be retained also along Maxwell Street. And the Public Works Department has requested that the utility easement along West Jackson Street also be depicted as a slope slash construction easement. During the review of the request by the Planning Commission, an adjoining property owner requested that the property be offered for sale in 2 tracts. We would like the opportunity to buy just a portion of it. A new survey of the property has been prepared by the Public Works Department, and it depicts those two separate parcels, which are shown on the screen now. It also depicts the easements that have been requested by the applicable city departments. The plat would be recorded if the property is sold in 2 tracts. The Planning Commission has approved the surplus property declaration and has recommended that the council approve the sale of the property in 2 tracts to the highest bidder or bidders, meeting an established minimum price, which would be based on an appraisal and subject to the retention of the requested easements. The Planning Department concurs with this recommendation.
We have a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion by the council?
So, how are you going to set the minimum?
We'll have an appraisal done, and that appraised value would be the minimum bid price for Planning Commission anticipated.
Is the appraisal to that amount?
Yes. Okay. So is the recordation cost.
What about the price for auction?
It would be an auction. We would do the, we would just be sealed bids. We would advertise and be sealed bids.
You did actually advertise it, didn't
we? Yes. This is about the fifth remnant that we've had that we sold on West Jackson. I think it's the last. The property that's just to the south of this was a remnant that was sold. There's been 2 or 3 others that basically have no use unless they're combined with other properties, and that's what we anticipate having here. This property also is subject to a 50-foot setback, which greatly limits how it can be used.
Any further comments on the council? Anyone in the audience would like to comment? Seeing none, all those, in favor of the motion, give it say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion passes, carries.
Thank you, folks. Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Item 8, to set a date, looks like May the 3rd or 7th, for a public hearing on ordinance 070409, closure and abandonment of an undeveloped street right-of-way adjacent to 1281 Cookeville Drive, sponsor Kevin Carter.
May the 3rd, 2017.
Thank you. Item 9, consider property acquisition, also the combination if necessary, for the Bunker Hill Road Sewer Project, sponsored by Ronnie Kelly.
Mayor and Council, go ahead and put this back. We're in the process of finishing up the design on the Bunker Hill Road Sewer Project that gets the Bunker Hill subdivision. And we're seeking council authorization to acquire property. There's going to be less than 10 parcels, but we need council authorization in case we need to go to condemnation. Right now, we do not anticipate at this point. And we recommend council authorization to go ahead and acquire any properties we need to obtain.
Do we have a motion and a second?
No approval.
Second. And a motion and a second. Any discussion by the council?
Most of this self-work looks to me like it's going to be in the right lane.
It's most of it is, yeah. There's just very few easements. And we're also having a neighborhood meeting April 12th, 6 p.m. to pull all the neighborhood in, let them look at our proposals, if there are changes need to be made by the residents. And so I think we've sent out, Gail, I think we're sending out an email to all the councils about it now. It'll be at our facility.
At the work.
6 o'clock, April 12th. And we sent out notices to all the residents.
So some of these residents, these less than 10, they're aware that they're...
Yes, we've been talking to them.
So you've had individual conversations with these property owners?
Mm-hmm.
And what kind of thoughts are you getting from
them?
They're excited about getting a sewer in that area?
Yeah, most everybody I've talked to is happy to get it and has sort of been looking forward to it.
But most of the residents affected by it are going to be off that Monticello circle, Mayor Carter.
Yes.
And when was your estimated time for getting it ready?
We would like to bid it in May. Is that what we're shooting for? We've got a couple of little issues down there around the St. Paul that we're trying to work with the property owners on. Trying to leave it free some big trees and keep out of those trees. So we're still working on that. That's one thing to sort of keep us held back when we're just going ahead and bid it.
Any further discussion on the council? Any discussion from the audience and comments? Seeing none, call for vote. All those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye. Opposed, motion carries.
Item 10, consider awarding the following bids. Item 10A, carpet for council chambers, general department, sponsor Jim Schiller.
Mayor and council, we received three bids for the carpet. It's active with council and amount of the hallway outside the council room. Low bid is from EMLA for $8,582.
We have a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion by the council?
I'll be glad when we're back in our own room. No offense to the county.
Any further comments? Any comments from the audience? Seeing none, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye. Opposed, motion carries.
Item 10B, mail server software, notes department, sponsor Jeff Lippin.
Mayor, City Council, we advertised and received bids for Microsoft Exchange Server 2007. It's a mail server software. I'd recommend for low bid ASAP Software Incorporated. This is also the state of Tennessee's bid for PBA.
We have a motion and a second.
So moved.
Second. Motion and a second. Any discussion from the council?
What exactly is this?
It's the exchange service mail server software for the PBA. Yes.
That won't change the aggressive or anything.
No, ma'am. It'll actually just upgrade. We're currently using the Exchange 98, so when it comes to 2007, but like hopefully it'll be a little bit better. We'll have a larger storage capacity as well.
Any further comments by the council? Any comments from the audience? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye. Opposed, motion carries.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Item 10C, SCBA cylinder accessories and air compressor, fuel station, air storage system, fire department, sponsor Chief Kennedy.
Mayor and council, I've got two separate bid tabs. If you'd like, I'll address both of them and answer any questions. The first bid tab is for SCBA cylinders and accessories, with ProFire equipment being the lowest median evaluated specs. This is a sole source bid because we're utilizing some of our current equipment without having to purchase as much. Their bid being $234,360.52. The same tab sheet is for air compressor, fuel station, air storage. Volunteer fire was low bid on air compressor at $16,835. The fuel station and air storage, pro fire was the lowest at $95.24 for the fuel station and $39.50 for the air storage. Both of these are part of the assistance to firefighter grant that we applied for and were awarded in December of 06. The federal share of this is 90%, which is going to be $242,000. Our share is going to be a little under $27,000. Part of that's going to require amendment to the budget. Some of that we're going to be absorbed with some of our current line items, but we're not going to be able to absorb all that.
We have a motion and a second. Motion and a second. Discussion on the council.
The three lower bids on the fuel station, is that, did you have to go to the higher one to match the equipment?
We had to go to the higher one because it was the first one to meet the specifications. We asked for it to bid the fuel four cylinders, to bid to increase the fueling time, to also provide the highest level of safety should one of those cylinders rupture and that's why we wound up going to that.
Any further comments by the council? Any comments from the audience? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Thank you. Brings us to item 10D, Recreation Center Gym Addition with Services Department, sponsor Rick Woods.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, we have received bids for the gymnasium. We received three bids, Nord Builders being the low bidder. Let me explain a little bit. The base bid, as you see, is the original design as we submitted it. We also had a couple of additions that came out after the plan was completed at our request. One of those was to add some windows to the gymnasium. That is the addition one. That would be an add of $5,765, as you see there. The other one is door hardware to get all of our locks in that building. Recreation Center currently is not on the same lock system as the rest of our buildings within our department, and this would retrofit the Recreation Center, make it match the gymnasium and all of our other facilities. That was an add-on of $6,525. We also asked the bidders to, there was some interest when we had a pre-bid conference. We asked the bidders, there was some interest by those potential bidders to extend the time period. There's 180 days to reach substantial completion in the bid specs. They asked for the possibility of extending that. So we sent out an addendum and asked them to send back to us a deduct if we were to extend it. So the one bid that we got had a deduct of $22,350 for a 30-day extension, so that would extend it to 210 days to reach substantial completion. I'm recommending Nord Builders with both of the additions, plus the 30-day extension, the deduct of the 30-day extension, which would bring the total price to $1,163,095, which is a savings of about $10,000 on their base bid. I'd be happy to answer any questions to you or from you, and I recommend your approval.
Do we have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the council?
Talk to me about the windows. I know we briefly in one of our meetings discussed that. I don't remember that ever being something that we decided on to be finalized. Where did that come from?
That was a request that came from council members to look at that. In fact, I think the mayor requested that we look at that. And these are fixed windows as they are. They're only on one side of the building. We have gone back and looked at that since the bid opening. We don't have good firm numbers yet on making them operable windows and doing them on both sides, but it would be, if that is what we choose to do, what you choose and wish us to do, we'll have to come back with a different price on that and do that as a new bid or as a change order.
How many windows is it?
I think there are 9 windows on one side.
Is this at the top?
Yes.
Okay. We also, in that same meeting, talked about fans. Does this include fans?
This does not include fans, and that's something else that we are researching currently, and that's something else we'd have to come back to you with. We do have initial information we've received this week from Nord Builders saying that we could add the large fans that would circulate and move the air in that gymnasium. A rough estimate at this point would be $15,000 added to that.
How many
units
is that?
2.
Okay, so what would be the ramifications of the windows related to increased heat in the facility and or lighting? Obviously, it's for natural light, I understand that, but as far as glare, are there will be things taken into account to keep that from hindering the usability of the space?
I have asked the architect to place those windows in such
such a way so it's not blinding if you're shooting a jump shot from the corner, if that's what you're concerned about. That is one potential problem that we see. The original design of the gymnasium had no windows in it. And we were just responding to the request to go back and look at it to see what it would be to put windows in.
So in fact, they can't locate the windows where it will not hinder, or the heat from that will not be, and this is something that won't be added, is that correct?
If that's what you so choose, yes.
Aren't those windows, some of those windows on the south?
Yes.
Which would be the chance that in the wintertime there would be sun coming through those type of windows. How it would reflect onto the plane floor, I don't know, but there's a good chance there.
So who decided that? That's my question.
I guess what the council chair might be asking me is, since we do have a couple more items that we're trying to clarify, i.e. fans, optical windows, and we are about, according to my estimation, $16,000-$17,000 of what we had allocated in the budget. It would make sense to get those items clarified before we proceed.
Or can we proceed with the base and then decide the additions later?
If that's what you would like to do, yes, we can do that.
I know it says that $1.1 million, part of that is for the grant through grant writing program we received, and part of this money says that. So, according to our estimate, we're about $70,000.
Well, if you take $22,000 reduction, you're about $50,000 over the funds that we have allocated at this point.
Yeah, but if you take the full pads and
right.
Back up.
Yeah, then but just take, a base bid.
Yeah. Is there a problem with waiting 2 weeks to try to get these other items determined from a
not at all.
Guaranteed cost?
Well, we're currently out there grading right now, working on the site with in-house with Public Works Department. So we're nowhere near ready to begin for the contractor to begin work.
If some expert will say that's a good day and it's not going to hinder anything, I'm by no means against the window for natural lighting, though, and I don't get me wrong. Somebody besides you and I, in the council, needs to say that. Because I don't know, and I don't know that you know, or anybody else here knows, but if some expert will say this is a good thing, then I don't have no problem with it. That's not, so please understand what I'm saying.
I understand.
Who can tell us that?
I know right now, too, and Mr. Brown kind of reminded me of that. I think there might be is there not a deadline for the purchasing of the building material itself? Or was there anything said as related to execution contract or any disclaimer?
To my knowledge, it wouldn't put us out. I mean,
no,
it is good for.
How long is the bid good for?
Right? Yeah, it's good for, I believe it's good for 30 days.
So if we wait
not longer.
If we wait until the 19th, that would be, we're still within the 30-day window, correct?
I'm pretty sure we are.
I'll make a motion to amend the bid, to approve the base bid, and then you come back to us since the windows and or the fans would not have to be added at this time, so we can go ahead and proceed with the building material or whatever. I would make that as a motion and or amendment if anybody wants to second that.
Well, let's amend that for a second. Let's go ahead and take the base bid with the data.
Correct.
That way we'll so base bid and the 30 days
come back to us with add-ons, whether it be the windows and the hardware and all the things that we're just like.
And that would get us on $1,000 of what we've got.
That way they go ahead and order it.
Sure.
That's
right.
Yeah. So I'll make that a motion.
A second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. As an amendment to the original motion. So we are, I guess with this, accepting the base bid and the 30-day extension deduction.
Correct.
Minus the addition ones and two. So we're voting on there.
amendment to the original motion, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, aye.
Yes, for motion carries.
Four, no. Now that brings us back to the original motion, correct?
So the motion is to accept the...
Is to accept the vacation of the 30-day extension deduction.
Well, didn't have a chance to talk about these gentlemen, but I think there were twofold, actually. One was if you create a box with some openings in it. One is if the power is out, obviously there's an emergency line, but it's a very dark space. Two is that the windows would provide natural lighting, so if somebody working at the facility needed to go into that room, they could go in there without having to charge all the metal highlight lights that would be on the ceilings. So it was a way to walk into the space without having to turn on the lights. And two was that they could provide ventilation. Most gyms, I think the architect, Peter Metz, we talked at the bid opening, he did not initially put those in the opening, but most gyms, when you pack a place full of people playing ball, it's going to warm up in there. And it may be overworking the cooling system to cool it off. So most heat rising to the ceiling, you could crack these windows and get natural ventilation through there without maybe having to overwork our heating and cooling system. And as far as finding a professional that can tell us, I was under the impression this was a recreation center, not some sort of a high-performance expo center that we're going to be having, the NBA playing. And this is going to be pickup games within the community, and I certainly take that in the most serious fashion, but at the same time, we can trust our architect, Peter Metz. He's the one that should be charged with finding out. So I say that we charge our architect to find out what it ought, and I think he indicated actually that bill when he would make certain that the windows would not interfere with the ball game. At least that's the impression.
I guess laying those windows, it's interweighing for ventilation, which I do not disagree with. This bid does not include ventilated windows. These are frosted windows,
right.
So we wouldn't be approving what you're asking for. Anyway, I'm by no means, as I said, against windows. I'm the natural light in here, and Peter Metz is the person, if he can assure that and get these windows that will open and ventilate and do that,
right.
That's not what this was about at all. So.
Well, and as far as the condition number two, no hardware, I think, is merely something that's really just going to help the leisure services department, this facility being in that building.
I agree. That's the last thing I said in the building is the hardware. So by the time we order the fans, hopefully we ask about fans as well. And I believe the Navy loads were... Something fans. That would also help with the ventilation of the building along the windows. So certainly those are things that can come back and we can add, and I'd be all for that.
And just for one clarification, I think you've done a great job. I don't think anyone's saying anything like that. I think he's done a great job. I think what we're trying to clarify is we want to be certain what we're committing to spend funds, city funds on. We want to be certain what we're buying is what we need. And so in an effort to do that, what we're asking you to do is go out, find out if we need operable windows, find out if we need them on both sides instead of one side, find out if they are operable, if we can use a fan system that would help us ventilate that system better, and then find us some doors that can operate well, because we want to do it right the first time. And I think you're doing a great job. I think there might be some confusion as to the need, but I think it's wisdom to go ahead, proceed with the base bid, and get these few items clarified. And I trust that you and your staff can do it.
Any further discussion on the council?
We need the original bid, the original
motion,
because we just voted on the amendment. So how is that original motion, how is it stated?
The motion as amended is to accept the base bid and the 30-day extension deduction.
That was the amendment.
That's what the motion now is. The amendment of the motion passed, so the motion now stands to accept the base bid and the 30-day extension, and exclude additions 1 and 2 by implication.
It's obvious to see the young guy is there, right?
Pardon?
It's obvious to see who didn't know that, right?
They don't know.
Who didn't know that?
Well, with understanding that we can come back to those two issues, something that we certainly need to do.
He's just going to come back with the bid tabulation, shows us all three options.
I mean, all three options.
Yes, I can.
Change orders. To what you're approving out of the base bid.
Correct.
Once you have a contract.
Very good. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as amended indicate, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Woods. Brings us item 10E, switch gears and installation of I-40 lighting phase one, alleged department sponsor Tony B.
Mayor and Council, I'd ask, since I have a bid on, hostile bid in the interstate lighting bid that you vote on these separately, I'd like to address the switchgear first. We're buying two sets of 15 kV switchgear. These are for the hospital tower addition. Low bid, meeting specs, we have the same price for two of our bidders. I'd like to split those by one from each. We've talked with the folks, they're okay with that. I would recommend that for your approval.
Do we have a motion and a second?
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion on the council?
These are for the Alpine Hospital?
That's correct.
Are they charged with the investment charge on this, or how's that work for me?
Yes, they will be. Council Shelton will keep up with all the, they'll have one meter at the hospital. Everything on the load side of that meter will be kept in an investment account, and they'll pay a percentage of that. Of course, we will maintain and replace that perpetually.
Any further discussion or comments from the council? Any comments from the audience? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Second item is our interstate lighting bid. For the public's benefit, I'd like to take just a minute, if I may, to give you a little bit of history about the interchange and the interstate lighting in Cookeville. Council's already heard a bit of this. But back in 1997 is when the projects first began. Intersection at Highway 111 and Highway 70 East was the first interchange that we looked at. That project was completed in February of 1998. Highway 111 and East 10th Street was completed in October of 98. I-40 at Highway 111 in December of 2002. I-40 at Highway 70 East in October of 2005, and I-40 and Will Avenue being the latest one. That was completed in December of 2005. While these projects were going on some years ago, we were asked, the city manager and I were asked to investigate the possibility of tying those intersections together, especially the I-40 intersection, since we've done the Willow, Jefferson was already done, and the two to the east. And we looked at that. I put money in the 05-06 fiscal budget to accomplish what was referred to as phase one. That was basically from Willow Avenue, which is 286, out to 111, which is 288. We were unable, the electric department was unable to get the design together and get the, we thought we could in that 05-06 budget, but it's a pretty lengthy process getting that approved through the state of Tennessee. Commissioner Nicely now wants all that stuff run across his desk, which delays that process. But anyway, we were unable to get the design completed and approved by the state in that fiscal period, but we thought we would go ahead and buy the material, have it on hand, maybe at about the same time we get the approval from the state. Well, that didn't happen. We purchased that material in April of 2006. So once again, put money in the fiscal 06-07 budget that we're in now. We finally were granted that approval from the state of Tennessee. We put out bid documents in October of 2006, and I may have talked to some of you. Got that bid back in. We opened it in November, possibly. It came in. We only had one bidder, and it was $800,000. I had projected that labor to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $225,000 to $250,000. So we really didn't bring that to you. We just run them a letter and say we're rejecting your bid. Looked at it, talked to some local contractors, trying to get local involvement, and changed the scope a tiny bit. Seemed like the local folks were telling us that they didn't want to make some of the electric connections. Pretty minor thing to us, we do it every day. So we took that out, rebid that. Recently opened it. I think we opened it in February of this year, and Loftus, Putnam Contracting Service, that's Chad Gilbert, and Elk Mountain Construction bid on the project. Loftus came in low at $177,230. Thought it was a very low bid compared. The state projects, what the state of Tennessee had hired contractors and installed structures for, and calculated that. And it seems like it would have been $455,000 had the state of Tennessee bid it and done it. So I think you've got a good bid. I bring it to you tonight for your consideration. Be happy to answer any questions, Mike.
Do we have a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion. What is our opinion for the light bill on these lights? It looks like it's going to be about $46,000 to $50,000 a year.
Yeah. The way that, and y'all probably know, but the way we handle street lighting for the city of Cookeville, street lighting is paid by tax dollars. The electric department happens to coordinate and install and maintain street lighting in Cookeville. Basically, what we do is we keep up with the investment, and we look at that every couple of years, what it's costing us to maintain, and whatever that maintenance cost is, that's how we determine what the percentage of investment on that total amount is going to be. Additionally, there are power costs. The lighting that we're talking about from 286 to 288, the city's annual lighting cost, will be somewhere in the neighborhood of $6,000. Of course, you know, the rates change a little bit, but it will be approximately $6,000 annually for that, for this project.
The things that concern me, and I've been concerned about this since it was first talked about in the budget, I guess the 0506 budget, and was told that we would have further discussion before it was ever voted. And that voting to approve the budget did not mean voting for this project. And at a time when particularly our community is being faced with, I think every community is being faced with increased demand on electricity usage and energy usage, most cities are looking forward into the future and doing projects that are more energy saving and conservation minded rather than lighting unnecessary stretches of road. You know, I fully support lighting those interchanges. I think it is a nice thing to come into a city and see that. I've said before that, you know, when you come into Cookeville, there's enough light that we can pretty much stand on any stretch of that 286 to 288 and pretty much read a newspaper about any time of the night. And, you know, as far as economic development, I just feel like we've got a real opportunity here to really bring sustainable economic development to our community. And I think one of the ways that you can do that is to invest this money that's already budgeted in a more sustainable way that draws significant attention to our community. If we weren't the home of Tennessee Tech, maybe it wouldn't make as much sense to do something like that. But we have a real opportunity as the home of a state technological university to portray our image of the community as a high-tech community and draw all those kinds of industries. I mean,
the national trend that we're seeing as far as economic development goes, from 98 to 2003, we lost 5 million manufacturing jobs, and we gained in that same period 35 million service jobs. And the kinds of jobs that our community needs to be looking for are the kinds of jobs that are technically minded and educated kind of jobs. And if we get manufacturing jobs, I'm all in favor of that. I think it's something that we need. We have, I think, a base of about 8,500 people in this county who rely tremendously on manufacturing, and we need jobs for those people. But the city of Cookeville should not be charged with making the federal interstate system safe. If this is a safety issue, and it sounds like it may very well be, Councilman Shelton's support, you know, I certainly think that we should approach the state or the National Highway Transportation Safety Board or General Vice Commissioner DDOT and see if they want any of them to make our highway safer out there. But to actually make the taxpayers and the ratepayers of the city of Cookeville being in charge of that road is just, it's setting the precedent for something that we may not want, a road we may not want to go down. I've got several examples here, and I've shared this with the council here, but there's a lot of cities that are doing projects that actually save money rather than cost money. And these are the kind of high-tech projects that I think would draw the attention to our community that could set the groundwork for sustainable jobs in the future. You know, this is quite a bit of money. $365,000, when we first accepted the bids on the, I think it was $187,500 worth of materials, my question to Tony Peake was that could these materials be used somewhere else? And the answer at that time, I think he still said it was well, yes. And I think Monday was the meeting that we had. He talked about the flex conduit being the only thing that would be wasted, and we're looking at about $21,000. It looks like for that, and maybe we could sell that back and find another community that would be interested in that. But what I see here is we're right on the edge of a cliff, putting the city of Cookeville on a liability of about $50,000 a year to power these lights. And that's about 1% on the tax rate for the property owners in the city of Cookeville. And, this is something that might have made a lot more sense 20 years ago if it wasn't so developed that by the interstate. But if you drive through Cookeville at night, you can't help but look into the city of Cookeville because it's lit up with all the businesses that we have along that interchange. Well, actually, all through there with the new, well, all kinds of businesses. I hesitate to start naming businesses up trying to get somebody out. But the point is, when you go into an auditorium to watch a performance, a concert, a play, whatever, typically they light the stage and they dim the auditorium. And they do that for a specific reason, and it's to make you look at what's happening on the stage. And so what I'm suggesting is, it's not completely dark out here on the interstate. Let's light the stage open for the city of Cookeville, and as people drive through here, make them look up for the city of Cookeville. If we put all these lights up, you're going to steal the thunder from all these companies that spent thousands of dollars on big lighted signs. So I would strongly urge the council to reconsider this, and maybe we could reinvest this money in a project that would save or even make the city of Cookeville money and portray ourselves as a high-tech community, home of Tennessee's debt, and save the taxpayers $50,000 a year if they're going to have to pay from now on.
I have a question. Excuse me, were you through?
I was through.
Okay, I'm sure you're not through, but anyway, I'm going to stop you for just 1 second to get a clarification. If you don't go forth with, if the city of Cookeville doesn't go forth with this project, you have $186,000 worth of, the only word that's coming to my mind is produce, and that's just because that's my kitchen. But you've got $186,000 worth of materials, that's it, that you have sitting ready to use. And what would your projection be for using that money that's already been invested in that? I mean, $186,000. If you can't get rid of the conduit, that's $21,000 that might go bad or might not be used. How long would it take you to use all of that material, and what cost would it be to the city of Cookeville for us having all that material?
And I answered you by telling you I'm not sure.
I mean, obviously, you can't say I'm going to be able to use 81 or 91 light poles and like that, but I mean, are you looking at 5 years of this stuff sitting? Or are you looking at 10 years? Are you looking at 2 years? You know, just
The material consists of poles, lights, wire, conduits. Other than the poles, we use the other stuff basically daily. Now, we have to keep a pretty large supply of that on hand because of the delivery dates on a lot of that material, and they're getting more difficult all the time. Having 91 additional lights, we'll probably use those up in a few years. The wire will go in a couple of years as well. The poles, that's up to you guys. I will use those poles on the roads that y'all tell the city to build. I don't have a clue when I would use those.
That's the other poles up on there in the drive.
That's correct.
Well,
and that is the, it happens to be the highest dollar item.
The pole.
The poles. So
but this was something that we set aside as far as the budget expenditure for this year, or the previous year for this year.
That is correct. And I think I left part of your question out. Expense to the city, really, the only thing immediately comes to mind is I pay in lieu of taxes in the city of Cookeville. It's like a corporate taxpayer. That is a state formula that has about three parts to it. One of those parts is how much inventory I have in stock. So it's going to increase my taxes that I pay to the city, which will tickle shipping to death, I'm sure. But other than the storage expense and those kind of things, the conduits, you may lose some of that. I just don't have a big enough area to store that. I doubt that they'd take it back. You'd probably have to pay somebody 20% or more to take that back. It's a year old now. They may not even want it. I don't know. That type of conduit, as Ryan alluded to on Monday, conduits are supposed to be put in the ground. So ultraviolet light and all of those kind of things affect that, especially flex. It becomes brittle and breaks apart. If y'all don't know, we wind up keeping that, we'll try to get some temporary storage for it. So.
Well, in thinking about all of this and deliberating it this week, definitely, and before, when I first came on to the council and the first time we talked about this lighting project, to be honest with everybody, I felt like it was a done deal. That, you know, I would put a rubber stamp on it and then we would go on. That this was stuff done before I got here, which has, by the way, been most of what I've been doing since August, is, you know, things that have been, and of course, it's a living entity and we keep going on and we have to always have that. So my first thought was, what's the big deal? This is something that's been budgeted, etc. Then my second thought is, I totally agree with Sam. Totally, 100%. I feel like that we as a city have to go forward and look to different means of energy, etc. 100% behind that, and I feel like that we can put ourselves on the map of Tennessee and maybe even the nation if we were more forward thinking, even if it cost us a little bit more money. And then thirdly, here comes this middle class practical. It bothers me that we have a pile of stuff that's been bought, the money's been spent. And to me, it means that it, I don't know, it just doesn't make sense to have a pile of stuff that you don't use. You know, and it makes me nervous to think that we can't get money back for that, or that it would take a long time for that to be recovered. And I also understand the, you know, if we're spending $46,000 a year forever to like a stretch of land, which is well lit, that bothers me too. So am I indecisive? Oh yeah.
Mr. Chairman, is it correct we spend $3 million per year lighting in the city? The investment in electricity?
No.
How much is it? Oh, that's what it says in the work session.
I believe Tony's saying that his investment in lighting is $3 million.
Physical feature. Well, okay, so the $40,000 would go in $3 million.
That's correct.
Okay, so how much electricity, what do we spend electricity per year lighting in the city?
Mikey, you pay the bills.
Roughly, we have in the budget, I think, $698,000 for utilities, and roughly the investment charge with the electric department is right now about $49,000 a month. The investment charge.
So $3.6 million per year to the electric department for the investment in electricity.
We're not paying them $3 million a year. We basically pay them $50,000 a month.
Right.
Tony's
investment. We're also not going to be paying them $46,000 either, like this.
No, $6,000 is a net increase in
the net
in the electricity.
The electricity use?
No.
These lights are going to cost $46,000 a year in power. To put the light, to put the energy to the light.
That's not correct.
$6,000.
This project. On top of that will be the investment.
On the investment. There will be a $40,000 investment in charge.
So that's what I'm saying. Right now, the investment is $3 million a year.
The city's total investment in all life that was ever installed 40 years ago is about $3 million per year. I can't give you that exact.
I'm just trying to get everything in relation. So that $3 million is that $40,000 to that $3 million, correct?
That $3 million. The $40,000 is a percentage of the $365 that will actually be outlaid by the electric department. I charge the city of Cookeville 11% annually on that investment, less than 1% a month. This $40,000 figure is that less than 1% a month. Or that $365,000.
$365,000 is what we added to the premium. So the actual net new cost to the city for this project will be
$40,150 annually for the investment, $6,000 annually for the power.
Okay, so that's less than 1% total. Increase.
1.2%. Our utilities bill, right now our utilities with the electric department is roughly $50,000 a month. We're going to add another $4,000 a month as a result of if you voted this in.
My point to that is this is not going to increase our tax rate by any raise in $62,000. This is not going to increase that because our growth is 7% per year anyway. So this is not going to physically increase out of taxpayers' pocket an extra penny having to pay to do this project. Mm-hmm.
Do you agree with that, Mr. Chairman?
I do not anticipate that this project is approved and moving in paying that bill, but it would require a tax increase.
We've been working on this project since 1997 as far as lighting the city. Start with as he gave you in the history. I am in a feeling that because we were proceeding with previous years since 1997, I agree that we should just continue and finish this project so that we can have it and most likely have it completed. Of course, change is inevitable, folks. We cannot just sit still. We are going to have to change. Change is painful, but we're just going to have to understand that there are prices we have to pay for progress, and I feel that this is something we started and we should just complete by going ahead and voting for this to block the remainder of the interstate to 6288.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, if you like, open it up to the audience.
Yeah, but I will. Yeah, one other comment I'd like to make, and I will, is that if we, our community, not Cookeville necessarily, but a lot of our good friends that live in the Bug Mountain and Dry Valley Road areas are feeling the pinch of what an increased energy demand means. And what it means is more substations, more transmission lines, and that means people's back doors are changed and their porches and their views are changed forever. And so I think Cookeville, you know, being that we have one of the, if not the greatest electric department director in the state, right there in the top five, that we should be investing in projects that prevent that kind of thing happening to Cookeville. Nobody wants a substation in their backyard. Nobody wants a new transmission line through their backyard. And this is the kind of thing, wasteful energy use, that promotes exactly that, those kinds of projects. So, again, I would encourage you to reconsider it, and at this time, I will, unless the council has any other comments, I'll open up.
I have one more question, if you don't mind.
Sure, go ahead.
We're calling, this thing is called Phase 1, and Ms. Practical sees the pile of stuff in the yard that needs to be used. If we vote to go forward with this, does that then say the city council is going to go ahead with phase 2, 3, blah, blah, blah? Because, you know, when the materials were bought, Mayor Salee thought that there would be further discussion, and so, and then will it look funky if we put phase 1 up and then don't, and then decide to go to a different project that doesn't include these kind of lines? Would that then, how would that appear? I mean, I'm just thinking here.
I think phase 2 and 3 would only happen if the council so chose to do it. I mean, if at some point the fifth interchange happened, or where, if at some point you wanted to expand the borders of this, I mean, this is the interior. If you wanted to go to city limit, you could do that, but it would take council initiation or
but I think
or him initiate, either one or the other. I mean,
each set of material purchases now right. Approved with council as well as
But then, like I said, when I came on board, I thought this was a done deed and that we were, you know, that it was already all decided, and what had been decided was to buy the material.
You could make an inference, certainly, that the purchasing of the material was approving the project.
Yes, and that's what I mean.
I mean, why would you purchase materials if you intend to proceed with the project?
So why would you do phase 1 if you weren't going to do phase 2?
Because they're totally separate.
Okay.
In fact, they don't hinge upon each other.
Okay.
Phase 1 hinges upon having the materials, but phase 2 and 3 does too. They have to purchase.
Okay.
That would be how I would answer the question.
And in my opinion, I feel like we probably shouldn't bid on the materials until we didn't go and buy the materials for the gymnasium and have them sitting on site before we approved that we would build the gymnasium. We agreed we would approve the gymnasium, and then now we bid it out and we'll go and acquire the materials.
Yeah, I agree. The part of this is that you do it yourself and you invest, you charge the city back as opposed to the council approving that. It goes through his budget, he charges us back. So that, I think that's the unique.
He's not doing this himself. We're going to pay Office Underground $177,000 still.
Well, I think one of the things to look at here saying is that this budget, this was a budget item. We was talking about a budget. Previous council approved the budget. And because they approved that budget, they then proceeded to purchase materials at that point. My mind is a confirmation of an original thought when you buy the material. And so, with that in mind, and I'm not trying to say that, but I think we can talk, you know, at great length about this, just as we did on Monday's work session. But I'd like to hear from, I think we should move to hear from the audience.
Yeah, I agree.
And bring it to vote.
If anybody would like to make any comments, you can come to the lectern and identify yourself, and we'll give you up to, usually we say 3 minutes, but we'll go 3 to 5, keep it short.
I'll be
three,
so I think we should
start
getting ready.
We can,
in fact, we have talked. We
council
have talked too long.
All right, 3 minutes for anybody in the council, and just state your name.
Thank you very much. Is this on?
Yes. Could you state your name very quickly?
My name is Barry Stein. I live on Buck Mountain, and I'd just like to offer an expert opinion relative to one issue that's involved in this project, and that is the issue of will illuminated Interstate 40 more than it is illuminated currently increase the degree to which drivers will stop and visit local businesses that are located near the interstate. Let me just start by saying that illumination obviously is important for humans to drive and navigate through the city of Cookeville. But perception, we found through research, is largely influenced by what are known as contrast effects. This is the difference between light and dark areas. For example, a relatively dim light bulb or a piece of paper will look fairly bright when it's compared to a very dark background. Similarly, if you put that same object near a lighter colored background, it will look dimmer. By lighting the interstates more brightly than they're lit right now, what you're effectively doing is to reduce the contrast between the lights in the background, the lighting in the businesses that surround the interstate, and the immediate context in which the driver is proceeding on the road, on the interstate. This reduced contrast effect has an effect on people's decision making and whether or not they think it would be interesting to stop in this area to visit. By illuminating the interstate, you're actually reducing people's perceived interest in the surroundings at night. It would be much better to magnify that contrast that exists between the dark areas on the interstate and the immediately surrounding areas around local businesses. You want to make, from a decision-making point of view and a study of perception, you want to make those businesses maximally visible, and you want to make their lights appear as bright as possible to attract interest. These are the things that, if you wanted to maximize people stopping on the interstate in Cookeville, you would do, along with providing them with as much advanced information as possible about the kinds of attractions and opportunities that exist in Cookeville. And at night, this could involve lighting various signs to alert people to what kinds of opportunities, as far as eating, entertainment, and things like shopping, are available for people as they approach the interstate exits.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Peggy Evans. I live in Honeybrook Subdivision, 2 blocks from exit 286. And I have enough light pollution as it is, number one. Number two, at the Home and Garden Show, quite a few immigrants, recent residents who moved here from Florida. They moved here from Florida because Florida no longer had country. And they won't live in the country where they see the stars, where there were trees. And they were upset more than just said something and said, oh, Cookeville Tree Board, you work the city. What's this of light in the interstate? And one long-haul trucker who retired here because he fell in love with the area said he stopped here many times because of Restaurant Row, not because of lights in the interstate. And I don't like the expense. I don't like the expenditure of electricity. And that's about it for now. And I'm just sorry this is under my radar personally until recently. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, and thank you for giving us this opportunity to talk. My name is Ada Haynes. I'm also a resident on Buck Mountain. And I'm one of those people who's facing one of those transmission lines in my backyard. And Cookeville, unlike Auburn, has this opportunity now to stop property owners from losing their property values. Also, I am a political economist, and one of my areas is economic development. And the area of economic development, you could do so much more. You've got this opportunity to put Cookeville on the map. We need to start creating as a community where taxpayers get a return on their investment. And so much of the research shows that economic development, you get so many more jobs for doing sustainable energy than you do for doing lighting projects like this. The research shows that for every dollar you spend on sustainable energy, you create for each dollar spent on sustainable energy compared to regular energy, you get 3 to 6 different jobs for sustainable energy. So if you want to talk economic development, you really do need to be looking at going sustainable. And having driven down the interstate recently and gone through some different states here in Kentucky, I saw some of those communities that were lit up on the interstate. And I didn't want to stop because all I saw were the lights on the interstate and blackness behind. And it made those communities look like there was nothing there because I was actually looking for a place to stop. I was trying to find a place to have dinner. I was like, these places look empty. All I can see is the lights on the interstate. So if we're really looking at economic development, I really hope you'll consider doing something more sustainable.
Good evening. Thank you. My name is Brian Pat. I'm in Jackson County. I get the benefit of Cookeville Site Pollution. Quite frankly, my home was partly chosen on a ridge top so that I could watch the stars. And at one point, I was seriously considering investing in a $2,000 telescope to do it. I've given up that idea because Cookeville has thrown up so much light in the sky. And of course, that light does no one any good. It's not even useful to airplanes. It certainly doesn't make the ground any safer underneath. I would ask you to consider actually adopting something exactly the opposite of what you're doing here, which is an ordinance eventually to control light pollution. And there are ordinances in cities all over the country, and those cities are more livable and safer when they control light and see it as down where people need it. I would call to your attention that TIOC has just issued a contract for a study of what's to happen to I-40 and what they call the I-40 corridor, and how much additional lanes have to be added to I-40, what parallel rail lines need to be developed, what other systems have to be developed. The state of Virginia right now is working on the idea of dumping, building a huge parallel trunkway to I-81, and dumping thousands of additional trucks on the I-40 every day. If that happens, I-40 may become practically unusable until it's wide. Every pole we put in will have to be taken down and moved and paved over if we have to add lanes on each side of I-40. And that's in the planning process right now because TDOT is doing the corridor study. It may take several years to work its way through, like the farm through the state, but it's going to be here. I would point out that the Supreme Court has decided that EPA is now going to regulate CO2 emissions and require the retrofit of power generation stations to reduce those emissions. The price of energy is only going in one direction in our society, and we all know it. Have we ever lived in a time when something went back down in terms of what it costs for energy? Oh, a few drops in the G's, a few cents in the price of gas once in a while, but basically it only goes up. What will happen is that, number one, there at some point will be an extra charge for CO2 emissions for the generation of power, whether it's a cap and trade system or whether it's a carbon tax. MIT estimates a carbon tax level is going to be set in the next few years that will increase the cost of energy about 30%. So don't figure out $6,000 a year for running the electric power to these things. Think of $9,000 and then think of more later on. Because what happens is you will also get scarcity. The United States government is not going to loan GBA another hundreds of millions of dollars, in fact, billions, to build a few more nuclear power plants that they're beginning to talk about. They're going to adopt a new energy policy in a few months. And after that, there'll be more debate. But I can assure you the federal taxpayers and the current deficit, I don't think, are going to ever come back and loan GBA money for more nuclear power. When there's less power to go around, there's going to be scarcity. And the way you deal with scarcity is to ration by Christ. And that's how we ration everything in our society. We ration by Christ. And those who have more can get more. That means the city has to compete with everybody else who wants that car.
Mr. Pat, thank you. That your time is up there. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Catherine Osler, and I live over on North Maple, not far from here. But that's Catherine with a K, by the way. And Osler with a U. And I have 2 points that I'd like to address. One of them is in response to Councilwoman Vice Mayor Davis's comment that opposing this mining, she sets it up as a conflict between people who are for progress and people who stand in the way of progress. And I guess what I would like to say is that sustainability is in fact progress. But that's a false dichotomy. And the people who are saying don't mine here, they are not saying let's all be dinosaurs and sit in the dark. They're saying let's do this in a more thoughtful and cost-effective way. And the second thing I would like to say is to Councilman Shelton, when he mentions that this is 1% of the budget, which is indeed a small percentage of the budget. But I would like to suggest that rather than spending that money, if we invest that small 1%, we can realize significant savings. There's a significant amount of research that indicates that sustainable development, some of the things Mayor Salih has suggested, will in fact return dividends rather than cost this community money. So again, I would like to suggest that this position is not lying in the interstate, and instead putting the money in sustainability projects and working on energy consumption is the forward moving and progressive position. Thank you.
Good evening, and thank you for letting me speak. My name is Pete Chaudhary. I live in Halifax Road. I wrote my statement down, and I don't think I'll read it, but I have enough copies for the council members to bear on. I'm really very concerned about global warming, and my motto is not to use more energy, but use less. Whatever we have, use it more efficiently. So I'd rather not have many lights, more lights, but the lights what we have, use them more efficiently. And that is why I like this idea here to replace the traffic lights with LED lights there for the traffic. It will save us a lot of money, a lot of energy. And I was reading some, you may have read the latest issue of Time magazine. There is a very good article about LEDs and other things, global warming. And the LED lights, they have two big advantages over incandescent bulbs. One, LED bulbs last for years, whereas the incandescent bulbs last maybe for a year or less. So there, you save a lot of money, too. And two, the LED bulbs save a lot of energy. One 15 or 20 watt LED will be as bright as a 100 watt incandescent bulb. So here you are saving 5 to 6 times more energy. So you do not have to spew up all those carbon dioxide in the air. So these are very two very important advantages. Not only that, recently they have been developing solar LEDs, which means you do not have to bring lines to energize LEDs. And solar light is free. So you save more energy, more money that way. And now I understand hundreds of cities are trying to replace the normal traffic lights with LED lights. Hundreds of them. Why not us? And lastly, I like to say that I really love Cookeville. It is a beautiful city. I've been here for 20 years. And that is the longest I've ever lived anywhere else because I love it. And it is a cultural city too. Of course, the presence of Tennessee State plays a big role in it. But now we have progressed a lot. We have kept it beautiful because of the foresightness of the city administrators. Now it is the time to move on. And this global warming is a big issue. And we should be smart enough to recognize it. So I think that my last sentence is that the first step to fight global warming with a simple measure, equip traffic lights with LEDs, will be a leader among the small cities. And I'd like to give this to you.
Well, why don't you do that? I'll just really quickly, I don't need to talk about this probably more than anybody needed to, but how many places I've got this and provided the council with this, Elkhart, Indiana, replacing 100% of their traditional 100-watt bulbs and city traffic lights with LEDs. Minneapolis, Minnesota recently installed two new solar arrays. They even got grants to do some of those things. Milwaukee, Wisconsin, a whole list of energy efficiency programs that only cost about $21,000 but yielded a savings of about $55,000. Louisville, Kentucky, the city's converted traffic signals from incandescent bulbs to LEDs with a savings of $250,000 annually. So, you know, there's, you know, actually this number is, of course, Denver's huge. Denver has done a LED lighting and saved, year 2004-2005, saved $817,000. We shouldn't say that much. We don't have any traffic systems. Anybody else from Allentown? Yes, sir.
George Alford of the Chamber of Commerce of the Plenty County, 1571 North Plantation Drive in the county, White Plains. I'm not sure the Chamber can add a lot to this discussion. I think it's been pretty well pulled. I do want to agree with Peggy and also with Alma. Up until just a few days ago, this sort of has been under the radar. I thought this project had already been approved and was moving forward. As you know, when you drive on I-40, the conventional wisdom has been, whether it's Jackson, Tennessee, or whether it's any city, especially city growing, you're seeing lighting of the interstate as a marketing gateway type two. And so that's one philosophy. There's other philosophies too. We certainly agree with both. I know it sounds wishy-washy, but we agree. We agree. You know, in the same community that has the AEDs, the defibrillators, I think you said, we're celebrating this evening, that's very forward thinking. So we certainly support efforts to make us a model city. But again, from a marketing, from a gateway approach, that has been a trend along the interstates. And that, again, we thought this project was already a done deal. Now, can you do a direct correlation with jobs created versus interstate lighting or lane, whatever we're talking about? That'd be very, very challenging to do. But we support Mayor Salee and forward thinking of trying to be a model city and vision and doing state-of-the-art type things that will create 21st century jobs. So we'd be happy to answer any questions. I want to point out the Chamber Board has not discussed this or passed on it as far as a specific issue on this, as far as is this particular project. We have passed the broad policy issues that, however, they do cover these things. So I'd be happy to answer any questions or comments if I would.
Okay, we're called the question indicated by saying aye. All those opposed? No.
No.
All right.
That was a call for question.
Right.
And it did not stick to her vote.
Right.
One final comment that I'd like to make. From the very beginning of this project, I had never had any intentions that it was something that was feasible for the city to undertake. This is actually, it seems to be one of the first opportunities to really actually make a decision on the project itself. I'd be just as happy with not spending the money at all, and the city of Cookeville not having a liability of $46,000 additional dollars a year. But being that it was budgeted,
that stuff there. You know, some of the projects that have come to mind were the LED signalization, which I think Eric Brown is working on, and on a different issue, you know, the solar panel issue for distributed generation, you can think of for a second there, to, and actually for security too. It's nice, I think, probably like our police and fire stations, would be nice to have those in a situation where they can have power when nobody else did. It'd be nice to know that you can still get in touch with those folks and they can have light. So, you know, there are better ways of not being able to spend this rather than putting the taxpayers' Cookeville on more liability for this. And I would certainly encourage you all to reconsider on supporting this project. Any further comments from there? Councilman?
I'd like to say,
any further comments? Any comments from that position? All in favor of the motion, indicate the same.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
All right. Item 11. Item 11, receive financial statements July 1st, 2006 through December 31st. Welcome to my case. Do I have a motion maybe to, I'd like to make a motion to defer this to the next council meeting if possible, but that's agreed. Got you a second? Motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion, indicate the same.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you.
At the end of our meetings, we have a hearing of citizens and annual delegations. We heard from a lot of citizens tonight. We appreciate you all coming. We appreciate your comments. For those of you at home, there were a few seats left in here tonight, and we would encourage you to show up for the next meeting, and we'll give you that opportunity as well. Any comments from the council?
I wanted to congratulate Jean Davis on the back page spread that she had in the town and city. It was great. I don't know if you guys get a chance to read it, but she took up the whole back page and question and answer period, and so I learned more about G. Davis in one article in the paper than I did in the town and city that I have in the last 9 months. So she's being commended for her work, and we really appreciate her for sitting up there and serving for us. I really appreciate that.
Well, thank you very much. But that newspaper does pick out someone, however, quarterly that newspaper comes out. And so everybody gets a full page, but not just me. But,
no, you shouldn't have told anybody that. Even Dave, even Bobby got his picture taken.
But I just want to say to those who feel that some of us who are not for progress and a way of being conservative with our planet and want to save our planet, I do a lot of those things. There's 51 things listed in the Time magazine, and I'm for a lot of those things. So I'm not opposed to, because I want to like the interstate, I'm not against trying to save our planet.
Any other comments? Or? Yes, sir.
I just, Rupert, I'd like to call one item to the council's attention, and maybe they would request the city attorney to investigate. There is a bill that just went out of the Senate Environment Committee of Tennessee Legislature that's apparently proposed by cultural interests. That would create a state zoning, the state zoning permits that you have now out in the countryside would expand that statewide, and it would supersede all local ordinances to control open permitting. We could not enforce a local permitting system or a local permitting ordinance if you have compliance with state law and preempts local permitting ordinance. You may want to look into that and see what it would do, because in some cases it does allow open burning day after day within 200 feet of occupying.
Make a motion to adjourn.